This is a Dharmanet presentation.
The main reason I've come this evening, I'm giving a talk tomorrow, I wanted to come an extra day. Many of you may know that in October 22nd, 2009, I arranged for the first ordination of bhikkhunis here in Australia, actually in the Western world. And having ordained bhikkhunis, one of them is sitting over there, Ajahn Nirodha. And it's after that, it's not just a case of opening the doors to women in Theravada Buddhism, it is also making sure they are supported and looked after. And that is also important. You don't just give birth to somebody. If you're a mother, you have to nurture them, look after them for many years. And so I did hear that sometimes the Santi doesn't have enough money to actually sponsor visas for people coming from overseas. I don't think that's really good enough. People should be able to come from whatever country to practice at Santi, especially when there's not the facilities in other places. So hopefully some of the money raised here can make it not a problem anymore. So any bhikkhuni, any nun from whatever tradition, because as Buddhists we always open our arms and doors to whatever traditions, can actually come and practice at Santi without needing to worry about how much it's going to cost for visas. And it's also, that means that we can actually establish a very strong community over there. So this is what I'm doing. Next February I'll be going to California to do exactly the same for the bhikkhuni monastery in California, because sometimes the bhikkhunis don't have the opportunity and they haven't got the respect to raise money to get them started in our world. This is a historic time, especially all you Buddhists here, Sri Lankan mostly, that this is a historic time in Buddhism that we are now reviving this bhikkhuni ordination. But of course, that makes my life incredibly busy. After the evening of the 12th of October, I flew to London, and from London giving many talks, one talk every night, and then afterwards flying off to Canada, to University of Toronto, to McGill University in Montreal, and Dalhousie in Nova Scotia. And then from there, flying to the University of Hamburg for three nights of talks. I met Aya Wimala over there. And after that, flying back to London to give more talks at the London Buddhist Vihara and also at Cambridge University. I only came back last Friday. And after a busy weekend at my own temple, I do have my own temple where I have to do work and my monastery, then fly over here today. And then tomorrow evening back to Perth, and Friday morning over to Malaysia, to Kuala Lumpur, and then afterwards to Singapore. I live a very busy life. And I mention this because sometimes people say, it's all right for you, you're a monk. What do you know about learning how to make peace in turmoil? I live in turmoil. Turmoil is my home, and I learn how to make peace within it, and at the same time learn how to advance some of the most important causes which we have. Because I know that sometimes as people worry about Buddhism, should Buddhism be so passive and never do anything? Or should Buddhism be proactive in our world and help solve some of these situations? And I'm trying to find a way of doing both immensely. So, you know, as a meditator, many of you know that, and I teach many meditation retreats, well sought after, author many books, and just for your information, one of my books on meditation, The Mindfulness, Bliss and Beyond, is now the standard text in Vietnam and Theravada Buddhism. Every monk who becomes a monk in Theravada Buddhism in Vietnam, and this is South Vietnam where Theravada is strong, they are obliged to read that book and they're tested on it afterwards. Which is means it's really well respected. And this is not in my tradition, not in Thai tradition, this is in Vietnam. And I remember just going to Vietnam last May, this is a funny story, going to Vietnam last May for a conference, and I was sitting in the hall there, and I was sitting next to a Vietnamese monk, and he just asked me very kindly, he said, where do you come from? I said, I come from Australia. And he said, oh, do you know Ajahn Brahm? And I said, I am Ajahn Brahm. he said, he was quite shocked. It was a funny story, but and that is all exactly as it happened, no exaggeration. But what it does mean that just I have authority to be able to know what I'm talking about. The balance between deep meditation and powerful service. How you can find peace within turmoil and still be really effective in this world. Now, the best story, there's many key stories which I have, and some of these key stories which I have, some of you may know these, but I start with a story and then I adapt it in different ways. And on the aircraft, talking to somebody on the way here from Perth, that some of these stories, actually on the car coming here, so not on the aircraft, that some of these stories are well used by psychologists. In fact, that in Toronto, whenever I go there, I'm invited to the University of Toronto to lecture in the Department of Buddhism, Mental Health and Psychology, which is a department, part of a degree course. And because many of the things which you say actually work. I was mentioning to my driver that one of the many psychologists who come to listen to my talks in Perth has said what other people say, said that I got my permission to practice as a psychologist by going to university, but I never learned anything there. I just got permission to teach or to practice. He said, everything which I really did learn, I learned from the monks and the nuns. And that's what she said as a Western psychologist. And that's also why, for those of you who've heard this big word, mindfulness, when I was in Halifax, that's Nova Scotia, that is the place where the largest Buddhist periodicals in North America are put together and edited, the Shambhala Sun, Buddha Dharma, and there's a new magazine called Mindfulness. It's just been released. With the support of the icons of the mindfulness movement, you know, people like John Kabat-Zinn, people like Alan Wallace, all these people who you read about, maybe they come and give lectures in Sydney. These people are Buddhists, and they've realized that they've left something out of mindfulness. It's not working as well as it should, even though it's incredibly popular now. And they feel guilty. This is what I was told by the editor in last week, or 2 weeks ago, in Nova Scotia. They really want to make the mindfulness stronger by adding the other parts of Buddhism into it. So this is latest movement. This is cutting edge. You hear it from here first, and you'll probably see it, you know, in your fields, in lectures, and also in symposiums and conferences in Sydney, maybe in 2 or 3 years' time. This is where it's starting. Because as Buddhists, especially as Buddhist monks, I've been a monk over 40 years now, that you actually learn how this mind works. And because you learn how it works from inside, you get these incredible techniques which are powerful, they work, and now we're sharing them with many, many people. And so I do live a busy life, but I learn how to keep it together and be able just to let go very quickly. And this is one of the key stories. And that key story is something I read, not in a Buddhist book, but in Tolstoy, a book of short stories which were written, not all by Tolstoy, I know Anton Chekhov did one of those stories, in Russia, pre-Soviet Union Russia, interestingly, to raise funds for the Jewish community, because these authors realized this community was being discriminated against. In the same way, now I realize female monastics are being discriminated against. That's why I'm working my butt off to try and help them. And in this particular case, it was for the Jewish community. And one of the stories written by Tolstoy was the famous Emperor's Three Questions. It's a very apt story for our modern age because many people today turn away from religion. The fastest growing religion in Australia is no religion. Which means that people, why do they get fed up with religion? And sometimes it's because it's ceremonies, sometimes it's arguing with each other, not having enough harmony and peace, full of rituals. So, as I put it, you cannot see the Buddha through the incense smoke. It's too many rituals, too much stuff. So people, they turn away from all this religious stuff. And so, this was a story of a similar time. Emperor decided he didn't want to have anything to do with any religion, but he realized spirituality was important, so he made up his own religion, and that religion was answering just three questions. The only questions he thought he ever needed answers for. When I first read that, it blew me away when I found out the answers to these three questions, and even today I teach it as a fundamental way to meditate and live one's life. It just goes so deep in all areas, and especially how to create peace in the turmoil of life. Those emperor's three questions: when is the most important time? Well, who is the most important person? What's the most important thing to do? Now, you've heard me talk many times, you've seen these talks on YouTube. Anyone who doesn't know the answer to those three questions probably has dementia. They've forgotten, because you've all heard it before. The answer to the three questions are: first, when is the most important time? It's always now. Who is the most important person? It's not yourself, it's not the Prime Minister, it's the person right in front of you. That was the key to understanding the power of this teaching. The person in front of you is always the most important person in the world. And the most important thing to do is just to care. Now, for those of you who are meditating, are you trying to, say, get jhanas? Are you trying to be mindful? Are you trying to see the breath? What is your meditation? If you're trying to get something, you're missing the whole point of meditation. The key to meditation is the mental state, the object of your consciousness right now. That is the most important. Not the light which comes up later on, not the bliss, not the breath. That is not important. The only important thing is the state of mind right now. And the most important thing to do is to care for it, not get rid of it, not try and change it, but make peace with it. And that's the same with whatever else you have to do in this world. So, whatever job I have to do, I know sometimes I do crazy jobs. Some of the crazy things I've done in my life was some of these nice stories. I went to go and do a radio show, talkback show at 10 p.m. in Perth after I finished a talk. I never knew what that radio show was going to be about. I just went into the studio late and put the headphones on and then was introduced to my co-presenter, who was a woman called Dr. Gabriel Morrissey, the author of many books in Australia, Professor, sorry, Gabriel Morrissey, on sex. Because the show was on adult themes, where I and Dr. Gabriel Morrissey had to receive calls from the general public on adult issues. And at that time, I think I'd been celibate for 30 years. What does a monk know about that stuff? But what did I do? That's the most important thing. The most important thing to do is to care. And it's incredible just how, after 5 minutes, now the callers had a chance. Who do you want to talk to? Dr. Gabriel Morrissey. And look, I got there too late to let them practice on saying my name. They couldn't say Ajahn Brahm Wangso Mahatera. That was out. Even Ajahn Brahm Wangso was too hard for them. Ajahn Brahm, I thought, would be okay, but that was too hard. Brahm was too much. So we agreed on, absolutely true, that we agreed on Mr. Monk. So the callers would say, can I speak to the professor, can I speak to Mr. Monk? And look, after 5 minutes, a two-hour show, all the calls were coming to Mr. Monk. And that actually quite blew my mind. Why was it that as a monk, they wanted you to answer their questions on adult issues, even though you haven't had sex for over 30 years at that time? Because there's something which a monk knows, and some how to answer these things. Now is the most important time. And the person, the caller, right in front of you, they were really important. So you can actually connect instead of trying to get rid of things. which means because you weren't struggling to get rid of things, you never felt stress. All stress comes when you don't accept this moment. Basically, you're not here. You're trying to get somewhere else. And that is very tiring. If you just be here, you know, even answering questions on sex, answering, well, the other stupid thing which I have to do is have my photograph taken. I still can't understand. I'm a fat old monk. I am not Sir Brad Pitt. I am not some movie star. Why do you want to take a photo of me? But people keep asking that, honestly. And just, you know, even in England, I sometimes almost miss my aircraft, people taking photos of me, signing books. So much so that, you know, I've developed this 20 push-ups. I train myself every morning to actually to smile, so I can do it on the camera, smile photograph. And I can keep smiling for 2 hours, no problem at all, because it's training, that's all it really is. So you can see just how... But a lot of times I think, what? I didn't become a monk to have my photograph taken. If that's why I became a monk, I'd be crazy. So what I do, though, that this is really important. Whatever this person wants to do, I'm very happy to do it. Sometimes people say, you know, you allow people to exploit you, Ajahn Brahm. You're like a doormat. I said, yes, that is the purpose of my life, to be exploited. So please exploit me. I'm not going to argue with that. I've given up trying to fight that. So that person in front of me is the most important person in the world. The event in front of me, the situation which I'm in, is the most important. And the only thing to do, which comes from this, is to care. Now that particular idea of caring, it came to me, you know, from another story, which is a key story, from a young man who I'd known since he was born. His parents would bring him to the temple. He was a Sri Lankan man. And when he went to school, he passed his university entrance, he did very well, did medicine, you know, always came to see me for advice every now and again. But once he came to see me, wanting to resign from being a doctor. His first year in the hospital as a resident, he lost his first patient. And it was a tragedy. It was a young woman under his care died. And it was him as the resident who had to go to the husband and tell this young man the woman he loved, committed to, had died. He had no wife, and that his two children had no mother. They died. And that hurt him so much. They went so deeply into him, he couldn't stand the thought of ever having to do that again. So the only option, he thought, was to resign, start another career. And he came to me for advice. And I saw his problem immediately. I said, your problem is you don't understand the purpose of being a doctor. You think the purpose of being a doctor is to cure people. It's not, because if you think that the whole reason to be a doctor is to cure people, you are going to fail many times. But if you change just one letter and realize the purpose of being a doctor is not to cure people, is to care for them. Just one letter, a U to an A, and it changes the whole situation. You won't always be able to cure people, but you will always be able to care for them. And as long as you're caring for them, even if they die, knowing they've been cared for, and the family knows that their wife, their mother has been cared for, that makes all the difference in the world. He understood. He was a very smart man. So, you know, he went back to work the next day, and he carried on. He's a specialist now, I forget in what. But he doesn't cure people anymore. He cares for them. And because caring is his priority, his cure rate goes up. He's a very successful doctor. And you can understand why. Why is it we always try and cure things rather than caring for things? So back to your meditation. don't cure your mind of its defilements, its sloth and torpor, its restlessness, its weird ways. If you try and cure it, you will just get stressed out, just like going to work. Care for your mind instead of curing it. Whatever's in the mind is important. Care for it. And then because, just like a body, a sickness, if you care for it, it gets better very quickly. If you try and cure it, it gets worse. So in life, in the turmoil of life, in the pain of life, please stop trying to cure life. Care for it instead. Now, some of you, even the nuns and the monks in front, think you understand loving kindness, metta, caring, compassion. How many of you, you know, do, say, metta meditation, loving kindness meditation in the morning? May all people be happy. May all people be well. That is not compassionate. I'll tell you why. At one retreat which I gave a few years ago, there was one young woman came up and she was really upset. She said, "You keep teaching me to be happy. You say, may all beings be happy, and that includes me. And I don't want to be happy. I'm grumpy. I'm upset. And now you make me feel guilty being upset." So I said, "Well, actually, that's not what I really meant." So I changed the Metta Sutta. May all people be happy if they want to. May all people be grumpy if they want to. Giving people permission to be, caring for them, not trying to cure them. And so much so that this woman, Veronica her name is, she's probably be famous now, and I'll tell you why. Because as a result of what she taught me, she said, "I feel grumpy, and I feel so bad about being grumpy." And I said, "No, it's okay to be grumpy." To make it very forceful, I went into the office, I said, "Just wait here for a couple of minutes," got on the computer, and I printed out a formal grumpy license. It was on a nice piece of paper, letterhead, and on it, it was, "This license gives to," Veronica, I won't say her surname, "permission to be grumpy at any time, for any reason or no reason, for the rest of her life. Signed, Ajahn Brahm." Because she respected me. So she was, from someone she respected, her teacher, she now had permission to be grumpy. And once she had that, she started to feel happy. You understand why? So because of that was one of the key stories. My latest book, which is available on Amazon, because it's really hard to get the English version here for the United States, is called, the title, "Don't Worry, Be Grumpy." That's the title of my latest book, "Don't Worry, Be Grumpy." And in the back there is a grumpy license, which you already pre-signed, you can cut out and put your own name in it. Now, do you understand what I mean here? It's because sometimes that grumpiness, not feeling that well, feeling a bit depressed, that is what's right in front of you in this moment. That is the most important thing in the world. Stop trying to chase it away. Don't cure it. Care for it. And then you find the problem is gone. This is why a lot of times people, they try psychology, they try meditation, it doesn't work because they don't understand. We're just all curers, all fixer-uppers, managers. We have a problem, we try and make it better. And what happens? It gets worse. Meditation, we try and fight our mind and we lose, we get frustrated. The reason is because we don't understand the psychology of this body and the mind. Even healing your body, you want to cure it instead of caring for it. And if you learn how to care for your body rather than curing it with this Emperor's Three Questions, now is the most important time. The thing in front of you, the feeling, the pain, the sickness, whatever it is, that's important. It's teaching you something. I'm pleasant, but only when you want to get rid of it. care for your sickness. I did this many years ago, 3 years ago. One of my powerful individual stories. What happened was I had food poisoning. It's what I always call, as a monk, an occupational hazard. Because I don't know what you give us to eat. I just put it in the tummy and just hope for the best. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. You know, once I'm going to Kuala Lumpur, Friday morning. Once, one of the last times I was at this temple, I was so sick, I don't know what they gave me to eat in the morning, but in the middle of the talk, I vomited. Because I couldn't hold it in. I was really trying to stop holding in, but it just went all over everywhere. People saw it. It was very good. From that time on, they asked me, what do you want to eat? Instead of just giving me what they thought I wanted to eat. So it was actually worth it in the long term. But this was not just feeling sick. This was full-on food poisoning, stomach cramps, agony. Couldn't help but screaming out. This is how I fixed it. Emperor's three questions. Now is the most important time. Forget what's going to happen in a moment or the next moment or 10 minutes down the track. This is the most important time right now. And this feeling, this pain, is the most important thing in the world for me. And my job is just to care for it. Not to get rid of it, but to care for it. Just changing an attitude. And because I cared for the pain, rather than trying to get rid of it, I noticed, my mindfulness noticed it getting a tiny bit less. I realized I was going in the right direction. More mindfulness. This most important thing is right now. That's called mindfulness. This thing right now, whatever it is, it's important. Don't get rid of it. Care for it. It got a bit less, and a bit less, and a bit less. It took 20 minutes because I had a clock in the cave where I was meditating. 20 minutes, that was all it took. And that food poisoning had totally vanished. Not even an irritation or an ache in the guts at all. No diarrhea, nothing. It was just perfectly normal, healthy digestive tract. And it was full-on food poisoning. To this day, I kind of wonder what happened. Because food poisoning is caused by bacteria. And that bacteria just messing around in your intestinal lining or something, making everything irritated. What happened to that bacteria? Because food poisoning had gone, I was no problem at all. Not even a slight irritation, just totally just without any symptoms. And I sort of imagined afterwards, because I don't know too much about biology, what a bacterium looks like, but I remember seeing one once, and it was just this little blob with little tentacles coming out. I call them tentacles, I don't know what they're really called. But anyway, I imagined that all those tentacles were cross-legged or hands in there. I imagined all the bacteria were now meditating. And because they were meditating in my intestines, they weren't causing any trouble anymore. It was a nice little vision anyway. But anyway, what happened? The Emperor's Three Questions, in the turmoil of sickness, I could find peace. By not trying to get rid of things, by allowing this moment to be, this was the only moment I had, and caring for that pain, not trying to get rid of it. It's like allowing myself to hurt, allowing myself to be grumpy, allowing whatever it is right now to be. That's one of the reasons I keep saying that in our modern world, I travel to so many cities, and it's the same in Sydney, it's very rare for me to see a human being. I don't know if there's any human beings in this room. There's human doings, human goings, but how often are you a human being? Just being here. Instead of trying to fix up something, trying to do something, trying to change something, trying to cure something. How often do you actually just be here? Coming back as a human being, instead of a human trying to fix something, trying to go somewhere, trying to do something. If you understand that, you understand why we don't find peace in the busyness of life. so easy to do, to find some peace. For example, 2 or 3 weeks ago when I was in London at the Thames Buddhist Vihara, I was supposed to arrive there nice and early, but for those of you being in London, traffic is horrendous. I got caught in a 3-hour traffic jam outside of Croydon. 3-hour traffic jam. It was only a couple of miles, but you know, it went really slowly. So when I arrived at the talk, you know, I was just in time, quick cup of tea and straight on the stage to give the talk. And as you all know, I don't really prepare anything. And now's the most important time. You don't worry about the future. So what should I talk about? And so I gave a talk on Buddhism and traffic jams. Why not? Because how many of you, even in Sydney, get caught in traffic jams? Now is the time to find peace in the turmoil of your daily grind to and from work in traffic jams. They're incredible opportunities. When you're in a traffic jam, you can't go forward, you can't go back. You're stuck in this moment. So this moment is the most important thing in the world. So what should you do? Honk your horn? Shout at the traffic lights? You know, just shout at the other people for just, you know, cutting in front of you? That's not wise. That just creates more turmoil in your life. Instead, just relax and enjoy the traffic jam. You can't change it. All the honking, all the shouting, all the bad thoughts, does that make the traffic go faster? Of course it doesn't. For those of you who get upset and angry in a traffic jam, you are not really wise Buddhists. You're not wise anything. You're creating more turmoil in your life. So just relax and enjoy it. You know, you can maybe even meditate a little bit, you know, if you're really stuck. Or just, you know, just make the mind nice and peaceful and calm. Become a human being anymore. It's very stressful actually driving, having to avoid all these idiots on the road. At least one thing, you don't have to worry about speed cameras in a traffic jam. So there's not many advantages in these things. So in the turmoil of life, in a traffic jam, you have an opportunity to relax and find some peace. If it's on the way to work, you're going to have to use your brain. It's hard work, you know, in our modern world. So why not, on the way, just keep the energies of your brain by not thinking too much. Relax. You don't have to do anything. If you don't have to do anything, don't do anything. This is one of my great sayings. That, you know, if you don't have to do anything, if there's nothing to do, do nothing. The saying, when you go home tonight, you know, if you look at the dishes which need to be done in your kitchen, before you start washing any dishes, please count the clean dishes, compare them to the number of dirty dishes, and if the clean ones are more, quit while you're ahead. Well, is the purpose of life having a clean kitchen? Or is the purpose of life having a peaceful mind and learning how to rest? Never do today, this is one of my favorite sayings, never do today what you can put off till tomorrow because you might die tonight. One day that's going to be true. You don't know which day it is. So put it off just in case. Do it tomorrow. And live your life. Be rather than go places. So the turmoil of life, you create most of the turmoil, not life, because you don't know how to deal with things like traffic jams. The red traffic lights, they're the most amazing invention. I keep telling people that every time, if you're a Buddhist, if you're a meditator, when you see a red traffic light, that should remind you of the Buddha. That's the Dhamma in every major intersection. For those of you who know Buddhist stories, how many of you remember Angulimala? Angulimala, he was this serial killer racing after the Buddha, trying to kill the Buddha. And the Buddha used some psychic thing that he could run faster than Usain Bolt. And the Angulimala was chasing after him and couldn't catch him. And he said to the Buddha, "Stop, monk, stop." It's a silly thing to say, "Stop so I can kill you." Who would stop? But anyway, the Buddha turned around and said, "I have stopped. You stop." And he realized this incredible meaning of stopping. Stop going places. Stop changing things. Stop curing things. Care instead. Be here. This moment is important. Stop and enjoy this moment. Be in this state of mind right now instead of going somewhere, changing it, trying to get somewhere. Be here. And that stopping, according to the old story, Angulimala understood that. That was his way of meditation. He became fully enlightened. Stop. Or this great story from Ajahn Chah's monastery. I usually only tell this on retreats. You know, in Asia, you know, you have these young monks ordained when they're 10, 11, 12 years of age. I don't agree with that at all. That's really, I think, against human rights, having a child go into a monastery at such a young age. But anyway, there was one of these kids, 10, 11, 12 years of age, and Ajahn Chah was giving this talk. And some of Ajahn Chah's talks, my master's, went on all night. Don't worry, I won't do that to you this evening. And this little fellow, 12 years of age, 11 years of age, he wanted to go to bed. He was tired. Now, young people need to sleep a lot. And he kept getting very upset. When is Ajahn Chah going to stop? When is he going to stop? 10 o'clock, when's he going to stop? 10:30, 11 o'clock, 11:30, when's he going to stop? And that thought kept playing in this little novice's mind. When is he going to stop? And then this little novice had what we call insight. Just changing your perception, just slightly. Just like the other day, Friday night, a woman came up to me. She was really upset because she's going through a divorce. You know how hard that can be, going through a divorce. And I just said, well, let's change it around a bit. Don't call it a divorce, call it recycling. You might as well say that, you know, there is recycling husbands, you know. Someone else gets him, you get another one. So And just like you did, as soon as I said that, she laughed her head off. She thought, that's a nice way of looking at it. So you just change it slightly, and it changes the whole way you look at things. So she was really upset at first, no, stressed out, turmoil of life, going through a divorce. And as soon as Ajahn Brahm comes on and says it's cycling, laughing, and all that pain went away. No, for 5 minutes anyway. But anyway, that just changing it slightly. So this little novice, he changed it slightly. Instead of, when is Ajahn Chah going to stop? This little novice thought, when am I going to stop? And that little novice stopped. When he opened his eyes, many hours later, it was dawn. All the monks had left. They'd done their chanting, rang the bell, and he was one happy little novice monk. He'd stopped and got into one of the deep meditations, just like Angulimala. Stop going places. Now is the most important time. This thing in front of you is important. Stop chasing it away. Care for it. Stop. So every time you are in your car on the way to work, and you come to the stoplights, and you think, when is the light going to change? No, when are you going to change? When are you going to stop? And be and find peace at the red traffic lights of life. In my first book, someone told me a story that in Delhi, the traffic lights were not stop lights. They had another word. I found out I was wrong. I went there, I couldn't see them anywhere. But I found out they're from Bangalore. In Bangalore, the red traffic lights never say stop. They have the five letters R-E-L-A-X. They are relaxed lights. Now imagine you did that in Sydney. instead of the stop sign, relax sign. Imagine the increase in mental health in this city when you're going to work and you see all these signs, relax. That's how you deal with the turmoil in life. You have so many opportunities to relax. I call those the in-between moments of your life. You've left some place, you haven't arrived at the destination. You're in between. You've arrived at this hotel, the talk hasn't started. You're in between. How many of those in-between moments of your life do you waste? Those are places, if you can grab them, you can learn how to find peace in the turmoil of life. First of all, recognizing the many, many in-between moments of your life, grabbing them, not doing anything, but enjoying doing nothing, just being here. If you can do that, you'll find life isn't stressful at all. Life is only stressful when you're busy trying to get somewhere else. When you learn how to be here, life isn't stressful, it's very peaceful and also very enlightening. As my master always used to say, meditation is not about attaining things, it's about letting go of things. Slowing down and stopping, not accelerating. I am a high achiever as a monk, because I know how to stop and be still. That's where you find wisdom, not by doing things, by stopping. And in your life, how many of you have to produce, do new things, be creative? How much time do you find out creativity is just repeating old stuff? To really be creative, you've got to be still and see things in a totally different way. One of the little sayings I told the president of Dalhousie University, he put this on his blog straight away, where everybody thinks the same, no one thinks at all. That's one of the problems, creativity, because we think all in the same way. No one thinks at all that way. But when you're still, when you're silent, then the juices of creativity can see things in a totally different way, in a new way, in an interesting and creative way. Stillness is my friend. That's where you get all the ideas from, not through thinking. So, by learning how to stop in this busy world and find that time, it's easy to find a lot of peace in the turmoil of life. But there is another wonderful technique which I developed, which again, psychologists are using without giving me 10% commission. This was when I have lots of responsibilities. Even if I'm not... Whoops! Very nice. Just let it be. You see, you don't have to do anything. It stops by itself. But, monastery. I got a big monastery, actually a couple of monasteries in Perth. I got a big Buddhist center to look after, as well as coming over here. So I've got huge responsibilities. But there was one day when in the monastery where I'm supposed to live, someone came and they were admiring it. This is a beautiful monastery. It's so serene and peaceful here. I said, are you kidding? Don't you know how much work it is running a monastery? And 23 monks you've got to look after, and there's always one going crazy. And you've got to counsel them and talk to them and try to keep them in robes and whatever. And all the committee, having to deal with a committee, you know what committees are like. There's always some politics going on somewhere and something going wrong and something bursting or some visa problem. Peaceful. This is a work camp here. And I'm the abbot. I've got the buck stops with me. And I realized, Ajahn Brahm, what are you a monk for? Just to work. And all these people, they come to your monastery and say how peaceful it is, and I can't enjoy my own monastery. So I realized the mistake was with me. So I developed this technique of pretending to be a visitor. So usually I'd work in our city monastery Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and go back Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday to the monastery where I lived, running two major centers. So on Monday morning, I made a resolution every Monday for a couple of hours, I would pretend to be a visitor. So if anything needed to be done, sorry, I'm not abbot today, I'm only visiting monk. And if somebody, one of the monks was getting psychotic, sorry, not my problem, I'm only visiting, you go and see one of the resident monks here. And if any of you lay people came and said, I've got a meditation question, sorry, I'm not the teacher today, I'm only visiting. Because when I was visiting, I had the same eyes as you would have if you came to visit the monastery in which I live. And I started seeing it with your eyes. See how peaceful it was, how beautiful it was. I didn't see all the things which needed to be cleaned up and fixed. Instead, I saw all the beauty in the place, all the peace. I could only appreciate my own monastery when I pretended to be a visitor. And then I shared that little practice with all the people who came to my center. Why not? Maybe tomorrow morning or maybe Saturday morning, pretend to be a visitor in the house in which you live. If you're a visitor to somebody else's house, do you ever wash the dishes for them, hoover the carpet, mow their lawn, take the garbage out? That's not your job, you don't live there. How many of you, you're visiting this hotel, how many of you will stay behind to hoover the carpet? Or even to wash the dishes, or whatever? Of course you don't do that, that's not your job, you're only visiting this place, which means you can enjoy it. So pretend to be a visitor in your own home, maybe Saturday morning for 2 hours. Nothing to do. I'm only a visitor. You don't have to wash the dishes, you don't have to cook, you don't have to clean. You can sit down and enjoy the house you spent so much money on. Instead of being another place where you have to work all the time. Now you know how to rest. If ever you are an owner, there's always stuff to do. When you have the mind of a visitor, you are free and you can enjoy. So sometimes I pretend to be a visitor to the body in which I live. I'm not going to brush my teeth, I'm not going to wash, I'm certainly not going to comb my hair. I'm not going to try and get sick, I'll get healthy. I'm just going to enjoy just being here as a visitor. I take no responsibility. And I do that with my meditation too. I'm only visiting my mind. I'm not going to try and change it. I'm not going to try and make it any different. Not my mind. I'm only visiting. And then I can enjoy it and find incredible peace. But if I own my mind, and if I have to try and fix it up, it becomes endless. But when I visit, I find incredible peace and happiness. That is another way you can enhance your meditation. Stop trying to fix up your mind. Stop trying to change it. Stop trying to make it different. Be a visitor, not an owner. That's another way of understanding the Buddhist teaching of anatta, non-self. You're a visitor, not an owner. Oh, what joy. I have no responsibility now. Fun, peace, freedom. As soon as I own my meditation, I'm in big trouble. So, try in your own home being a visitor, not an owner. And you'll find peace, you'll find more in-between moments where you can just enjoy, rather than always having to do things, always having to go somewhere, always having to make things different. My last little story, before I open up for questions, because time goes really quickly. You know, it's already, should have finished, I think. I don't know. Is this right? Who cares? Last little story, I've been getting a lot of mileage out of this. Especially, I told this story on Friday night, that during the rains retreat, don't usually go places, and I did accept an invitation to go and give a lecture at the a mental health conference. And these were for mental health, people in the mental health field, but also for people, what they call the clients, the people receiving all these treatments for mental health. And they wanted me to give like a little talk. And then this lady came up to me afterwards, and she said, Ajahn Brahm, when you first came in here, in your robe, I thought, what's this wanker coming in here for? That's what she said. And that's not a nice word, but she said, I came to apologize for thinking that, because you made me cry, you made me laugh, thank you so much. And the story which made her cry, which changed her whole perception of what I was doing, was the story of the tree in the forest. Because so many people who come to my monastery or to the city center or people I see, so many of them, they're always having psychological problems. They've been abused in the past, physically, maybe sexually. They've had some very difficult experiences in life. And they're suffering and they're wounded. And I ask them, have you ever been on a walk in the forest? And if you go on a walk in the forest, have you ever seen a perfect tree? By which I mean one which is dead straight, with all the branches equally spaced, with only beautiful healthy green leaves, no leaves which are mottled or eaten by the insects, the bark perfectly smooth with no scars on the bark, one which is straight instead of being crooked. Have you ever seen a tree like that? And they say, no, because all the trees in the forest are all bent, they're all crooked. Branches have been torn off by the storms. The leaves are eaten by the insects or like the parrots. And the bark is all knobbly and scarred. Every tree I've seen has been damaged. And those are the trees which are the most beautiful. I like the crooked ones. You know, they're bent all over the place and their bark has got so many scars on it. Now there's holes there where branches have been torn off, and in those holes that's where the birds live and the possums and other animals. Those are the beautiful trees. So I tell people who have been injured by life, if you are damaged goods, you are one of the beautiful trees in the forest, the ones I love the most. Don't you like the crooked trees? The ones which are bent and leaning over and scarred. Are those the trees you like? The ones I like. So if you've got a husband who's all crooked and bent, he's beautiful. If you've got a wife who's all scarred, gorgeous. Just like the trees in a forest. Once you change your perception of these things, the problem vanishes. And I was in Germany with Venerable Vimala over there, and I was saying how much German people love the forest. There's something in their genes. And I said, I've never ever seen a German or heard of a German going into the forest they love with a plane and sandpaper trying to smooth the barks of all the trees or trying to straighten them up. Even German people like perfection. They're great engineers, but they don't do that to trees. They love the trees as they are. Bent, crooked, scarred. Can't we do that to ourselves and to our friends and the people sitting next to us? You are bent, you are scarred, crooked all over the place. And that's what makes you so gorgeous and beautiful. That is called caring, not curing. That means loving life instead of trying to fix it. That means being at peace with things. Loving turmoil. Turmoil is cool and awesome. And as soon as you love it, it's not turmoil anymore. As soon as you are caring for whatever mind state you are in right now, instead of trying to change it, you find contentment. From contentment, you get peace. From peace, stillness. Stillness, joy. From joy, you get jhanas. From jhanas, you get enlightenment. It's the path of the Buddha. Contentment is an important part of life. And are you going to try and fix everything before you get content? How many of you have been trying to fix your husband? You've been trying your life to fix your husband. You'll never make it. You'll die before he gets cured. But you can care for him right now. Change your wife. Give her a boob job, new nose, new hairstyle or whatever for her birthday. That one. That's curing her. It's not caring for her. Curing your kids. Trying to make them do better at school. Look, half of your children will be below average intelligence. But not my children. No, not mine. Mine are above. Of course, that has to be. Half of you have to have children below average intelligence. That's obvious. That's logic. But no, not my children. So for goodness sake, don't try and cure your child. Care for him. Totally different ball game. If you can do that, it's amazing just how all those problems you have with your kids vanish. You're not trying to push them anymore. I always say to people, if you, any parents here, especially if you're Buddhist, if your child comes in the top 5% or bottom 5% at school or university, you are not good Buddhist parents. Because in Buddhism, we believe in the middle way. If your child's in the middle somewhere, good parents, well done. Take the pressure off your kids, for goodness sake. Care for them instead of trying to cure them. And then you find they become emotionally geniuses. So this is actually how we find some peace in the turmoil of life. You can't change life, but you can certainly change your attitudes towards it. Change the way you look at it. It's not just life, because sometimes people say, oh, Ajahn Brahm, you just talk about lay things. You never talk about deep Dhamma. Well, those empathy questions are the deepest teachings you ever need. They're simple, but please don't ever think that simple teachings aren't profound. Sometimes people want to hear stuff you can't comprehend. I've been there, I've been to talks before. Did you understand that, what that monk said? No, I didn't understand it. It must be deep. That's crazy. It was gobbledygook, it wasn't deep. So sometimes the simplest teachings can be the deepest. Now the most important time, when you're meditating, you monks and nuns in the front, stop worrying about what's coming next. The thing in front of you, even if it's sloth and torpor, you know, the tiredness, restlessness, please don't demean it. It's important. Why? Because it's here. It's going to teach you something. Don't try and get rid of it. Care for it. And that means whatever you are experiencing in your meditation, whatever it is, you're developing contentment with it. You're happy to be here, instead of always trying to get somewhere else. When you're happy to be here with contentment, then your meditation gets incredibly deep. And all these things which I talk about, you know, nimittas, these lights in the mind, the jhanas, bliss better than sex, all that sort of stuff, that just comes to you. It's built up by learning how to care for this moment and giving it importance, not trying to get rid of things. Then you find in the deepest of meditations, what works is what works in your daily life. So you can be an Ajahn Brahm flying all over the world, but I don't actually go anywhere. I sit down in the aircraft moves, I don't. You can be still, even when the world is changing around you. Why? Because you don't fight, you care, and then the world changes. That's the way you find peace, even in the turmoil of life. The world around you is turmoil, but you are in the center of stillness. Thank you for listening.